Hello everyone, and welcome to the Lexus GS. The GS. Back when Lexus wasn't all about SUVs and hybrids, this was their answer if you wanted luxury and performance. For this fourth generation GS in particular, as the first sporty model to be released after the venerable LFA, it had gigantic shoes to fill. And this 2013 GS350 Ultimate we have today certainly makes a strong case. Under the hood sits the bulletproof 2GR FSE, a naturally aspirated 3.5-liter V6 delivering 310 horsepower and 377 Nm of torque to the rear wheels. On the inside though, it gets even better. 18-way adjustable heated and cooled front seats, tri-zone climate control with an automated system to send air only to where vehicle occupants are seated, a 12.3-inch infotainment display with media controls for the rear seats, a powered rear sunshade, adaptive dampers for the suspension, and probably another page-long list of amenities. Add to that Lexus quality and reliability, and we should have a winner on our hands, right? Yes, but I'll let Live Me tell you all about that. All right, everyone, the Lexus GS. Now, to be clear, this is an old car, more than 10 years at this point, and it has aged incredibly gracefully, and to me, it still looks fantastic. It has a bit of athleticism with the strong hood bulge and the slightly flared wheel arches, yet it looks incredibly elegant and sophisticated thanks to clean, simple, minimalistic lines which have a smoother surface treatment than other Lexus models. Today we have it finished in this gorgeous, gorgeous obsidian black paint, and especially in the sunlight, I love how reflective it is and how you can see a little bit of that paint flake sparkling. Combine this with the super, super polished and reflective chrome strip around the windows, and you know what? You have yourself a muscular yet graceful car with quite a bit of road presence. I love it. On the inside though, it gets even better. Okay, on the inside of the Lexus GS, now I know styling is subjective, but I think it is gorgeous. It has really elegant flowing lines that are quite cohesive with the outside. So you have really nice swoops here. I enjoy how the surround for the aircon vents connect with the lines towards the centerpiece here, which is an analog clock. Love that. Really classes up the interior. In terms of materials, well, everything feels luxurious and plush. So, wooden and leather-wrapped steering wheel. I love holding this every time because it genuinely feels like you're driving a luxury car. Aside from that, you also have some incredibly plush leather on the dashboard with some gorgeous contrasting stitching. Same thing on the door cards. You also have this linear espresso wood trim. Everything you touch exudes quality. And in terms of ergonomics, in your driving position, all the surfaces that your body interacts with does genuinely feel soft and comfortable. So the seats themselves, my God, these are fantastic. I think Lexus makes some of the best seats in the business. The headrest, oh, that is super soft and supple. The seat, soft yet incredibly supportive. You have tons of adjustment on the side here, including the bolsters and the shoulder rest and the leg rest. You can even extend that if you want more under thigh support. It is just fantastic. Not to mention all the surfaces that the rest of your limbs touch, like the armrest, super yielding, the door card armrest, again, more of that super plush material. Even where your knees touch, this is super soft, that is super soft. Ah, it's just nirvana in here. Honestly, Lexus has it nailed. All the buttons are easy to reach. The switch gear, the buttons for the window controls, the seat memory settings, even the HVAC system. All of that is fantastic. One thing I want to highlight here, this especially really classes up the interior. This is genuinely all metal, including the dials, and they just have a lovely, smooth action to them. What this feels like is a piece of high-end Japanese hi-fi equipment. Fantastic. Easy to figure out what everything does. In terms of practicality, yes, cup holders, huge door bins, more bins, and in the back you also have a treatment of door bins and cubbies aplenty. Seats are also very comfortable back there, but legroom and headroom, a little bit tight for reference. I'm 6'1 in height, and yeah, it could be a little roomier, but the seats themselves, again, just like the front, incredibly supportive and bolstered, except the middle one. That one's just bad. Okay, now, ergonomics, material quality, design-wise, perfect. The screens are also fantastic. So here you have a lovely silver-trimmed analog gauge cluster with an actual screen, which has some useful information there, like fuel economy and range and so on. The center screen also fantastic. It's huge, 12.3 inches, which is the widest of any car at that age. And the screen itself, even by today's standards, is absolutely phenomenal. You got great resolution, you have fantastic color reproduction, and a good contrast ratio. The menus in the car interface are actually quite dark, and there's barely noticeable backlight bleed at all, which is great to see. What isn't great to see is this thing Lexus calls the remote touch system. Unlike BMW's iDrive and the Mercedes command system, which uses a swivel wheel, which means you turn it left or right to do stuff, this, you have more freedom to operate, which in many parts is a bad thing. So let's say you're driving, you're already using a ton of your brain power to focus the car on the road and, you know, not die. And then you have this, which requires more hand-eye coordination. So for reference, this is an aftermarket system which I had installed. It's a CarPlay system, which doesn't come standard because it wasn't invented yet. So moving back to the original system, let's just go to the main menu. So the menu itself actually kind of reminds me of Gran Turismo 4 and 5. Even the tones and chimes when you select menus are all very relaxing to hear. They remind me of that time, quite nostalgic. What I don't like is how much thought you have to put in when using the system. So if it's a touchscreen, although the menus are not that intuitive, I can forgive it because it's an old system. You can easily access anything you want if you can just press it or use a swivel wheel like on some Lexus models of this age. I drove a 2016 ES which had a swivel wheel. That was much easier to use. This though, because this little cursor thing can move up, down, left, and right, you have a lot of different ways to navigate the menu. And as a result, if you're driving, because you have to also think about the direction, not just of your car, but of the cursor itself, it's really not an easy thing to use on the move. I actually have to stop every time I want to change or use this system, which is why I had CarPlay installed. So overall, interior, fantastic, still looks really modern and luxurious. The only thing I don't like is the infotainment system, but otherwise it is superb for such an old vehicle. Now, in terms of driving position, excellent as well. The dash is quite low. You can see the hood of the car and those front bulges converging into the front grille. Love that. Makes it really easy to pinpoint the corners of the car, as does the big side mirrors. And if you can see here, past the dotted line, you actually have the mirror curving inward, so you can actually see a little bit more in terms of field of view than you otherwise would with a flat mirror. Again, that just helps you a little bit when navigating tight spaces or when pulling out of junctions, because you don't have to really move your head that far back, which just makes this car even easier and even more livable on a daily basis. And that's really the ethos of this car. Lexus wanted to make it livable and just an easy car to get along with, but with some performance chops this time around compared to other Lexus models. So, let's drive. Let's get the more boring driving stuff out of the way. You got great visibility, as I said, you have big mirrors, and when parking, Although I don't think this came with a park, an auto park system like modern Lexuses do, but when you put it into reverse, the mirrors auto tilt down and you can easily see where the rear wheels are so you don't curb those beautiful alloys. The reversing camera is surprisingly high definition for the age of the car, and check it out. In terms of, you know, doing stuff like perpendicular parking or parallel parking, all the assistances and the fact that this comes with all-round parking sensors really gives you a surprising level of confidence when navigating tight spaces in this vehicle. So that's all well and good. But what is it like when you go on slightly faster roads? So the one question that pops into my head whenever driving one of these is, does it do the Lexus stuff? What I mean by that is it comfortable? Is it refined? Is it easy to live with? Is it luxurious? Well, the answer to all those questions, speaking as the owner of this vehicle, I would have to say, yes, it deals with all of those supremely well. First of all, it's been incredibly easy to live with. I've owned this car for, I think, about half a year, maybe more. And you know what? It has treated me with nothing other than happy memories and easy times. Nothing has gone wrong with this, ever. With the power plant, with the suspension, nothing. And one of the main reasons that is because of the power plant under the hood that has been in production for the last 20 or so years. Now, why does that help? Well, if Toyota has taught us anything for the past how many years, it's that they use old stuff because it's been perfected over the years that it's been produced. This particular engine has been used in a lot of stuff, and as a result, parts are everywhere, and because it's a Toyota engine, it's cheap. Yeah, fuel efficiency doesn't exist in this thing's dictionary. But it's been nothing but reliable and trouble-free the entire time that I've been owning it. And because it has 3.5 liters of displacement, it's actually quite powerful down low. In sedate driving, which is what I'm doing now, it barely goes above 2,000 RPM. Though you do hear it a little bit, when accelerating, it does make a little bit of a V6 noise, which is kind of nice, but it's not completely disconnected from the driver. The philosophy with this car is it's supposed to be engaging, and as a result, the car, although it damps everything and makes everything lovely, luxurious, and generally just very smooth, the power plant's very smooth, the steering's very smooth, it doesn't disconnect the driver from any of the important senses. Like, the engine sound is quiet, but it's there. And this is supremely supple in the way that it rides. It almost has like a floaty feeling to it, but it's very controlled. But the thing that impresses me most about the suspension setup in the car is the fact that it's able to isolate you from the really harsh bumps. Like, I don't feel any rough G-forces going to my head, yet through the suspension, I feel the road surface, through the steering, I feel the minute vibrations that can define road texture. Though that does come with a little bit of a sacrifice. The steering is surprisingly heavy for a Lexus. It's no E90, that is very heavy, but it's sort of in between an E90 and an E-Class of this generation. It's sort of in the middle in the way that the road texture is delivered and the way the steering feels when you pull it in a corner, the way it weights up. So it's not as luxurious or smooth as a dedicated luxury car is, but for a supposed midpoint between luxury and performance, I'd say it's doing a very good job. So overall, this does do all of the Lexus stuff that Lexuses are designed to do. But if you want to have some fun, can this Lexus really deliver? So the car now is in sports mode, manual mode for the transmission. This thing can really, really hustle. It's really impressive. So first thing to note, the suspension, it's not actually that stiff. What this does, what Sports S Plus mode does, if you have the adaptive variable suspension, it doesn't really firm up to the point where you have any jarring motions in your head. What it does is simply remove all of the unnecessary motions in the suspension travel. So when you go over a bump, you don't have any wafting motion, you just have critical damping, which makes the body a lot more controlled. I notice that there is significantly less body roll in the corners than when in normal mode, which is really great because the car already handles extremely well. The weight distribution is near perfect, and there's tons of grip from those tires, and the way the steering responds just adds to the fun. Because you know what? This thing sort of reminds me of the Model 3. Now, don't get me wrong, the on-center feel is not nearly as good as that. In fact, it's a little bit vague what's happening in the middle. But you get immediate response the moment you turn the wheel. Then there's the engine. Now, at 310 horsepower, it's got some decent pep. 0 to 100 in the mid 5-second range is no slouch, especially for this class of car. But the really special thing is the way this sings. Now, like I said earlier, below 2000 RPM, nothing really happens in terms of noise. You get a deep, bassy V6 sound, like I said, but there's no drama to it. But beyond 3000, the intake starts to wake up. You hear a bit of a growl, then overtones, harmonies start melding together. And the power builds and builds and builds until you realize you're flying. Because this is a naturally aspirated engine, you do have to rev it to get the most out of it. But that's no bad thing. Because the way this sounds when you get on it, even at 3,000, 4,000 RPM, it makes you want to push it. Just magnificent. That said, the transmission does let it down a little bit. Here's why. Check it out. It does feel slow, and as a result, it's not as rewarding as I would have liked it to feel in manual mode. In normal driving, it shifts very smoothly. You barely notice the gear change. But this is nothing next to a Porsche PDK or even a DSG from Volkswagen. But it's tuned for luxury, so I can accept that. The car doesn't feel as raw or as visceral as like a true sports car does. And it's not designed to do that, so I'm not going to knock it down for that. To me, this is more of a grand touring sedan. Kind of like how the LC is not really a sports car, but it's a grand tour. You're meant to just enjoy driving at a moderate pace. Because when you're cocooned and all these materials, when you have a car that makes you feel as at ease, as relaxed as this, you don't need to drive it fast. So, put it back in automatic, put it back in normal mode, and just listen to some music on that gorgeous Mark Levinson sound system. You know, there is something to be said about a Toyota luxury car. While Toyota isn't really known for producing luxury cars, what it is known for is quality and reliability. Those two words keep popping up. But for me, I mean, not all of you might agree, but for me, a luxury car has to do everything well. Not only do you have to be surrounded by the most exquisite materials known to man, but you should also have a car that's easy to live with, that makes life relaxing, that makes life more pleasant and enjoyable for you. And although, yes, there are plenty of German cars that may be more exotic, maybe more fun to drive, or maybe just more special than the GS, which is essentially just a Toyota Crown in a tuxedo, this, for me, is more luxurious than all of them, simply because I know this is going to last no matter what I do with it. If I want to drive it sedately, enjoying the moment, the car is going to be just fine with it. If I want to chuck it around some bends, listen to that glorious V6 roar, the car is going to have no problem with it. No matter what you do, at its core, it's a Toyota, which means it's just going to be there for me.